Good. Yes, thank you, Peter, for that introduction. Yeah, it's 37 years I've been playing around with acoustics. About a 2-to-1 split between the private and the public sector. And for 15 years of that existence, I was a technical advisor to the policy official at DEFRA. And actually, it's their predecessors. They didn't become DEFRA until about 2 years into that period. And as Peter said, the last 4 years, up until January this year, I was actually on the inside, which was a very interesting experience. But my fixed-term contract came to an end, and I didn't want to retire, although some people might have thought I should have done. And hence, Stephen Turner Acoustics Limited is one of the newer acoustic firms on the block. So see what happens. It's one thing I haven't really done in my career yet is work for myself. And at the moment, it's a very pleasurable experience. I've got the fun of a VAT return next week. I can hardly wait. So what I'm going to do tonight and is to talk about policy. And it's really the rules of the game. It will have to be almost of necessity policy in England because our friends in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland do their own thing, but they don't separate totally. And I mean, one of the features of DEFRA is that there are regular liaisons, formally or informally, with the colleagues in Scotland, Northern Ireland, and Wales, particularly on the Environmental Noise Directive, which is a UK thing we have to do for Europe. So I'm going to talk about some background to the development of the Noise Policy Statement for England, then a little bit about the NPSC. Then to look how it has permeated other government policy over the 5 years of its existence. And then towards the end, look at some examples of use that I've found. It's not systematic, this. It's purely me having a vague idea that I thought somebody had done something on this and had a look at the detail. So it's not comprehensive. But I quite enjoyed it because it was quite interesting to see what is happening. And you know, maybe if we survive the course, we can get to that. It's going to be quite a long presentation because there's actually quite a lot to get through. So hopefully I will keep it interesting and keep it moving through. I'm also conscious that some of you will know quite a lot of what I'm going to talk about. But I have to assume that some of you, it's going to be quite new and don't realise that actually this is the framework we're operating in. I think none of you will have seen every slide that I've got here tonight. So at least there's going to be something new for each of you. So if we go, first of all, to the background of the Noise Policy Statement, its genesis can be traced back to something that happened in 2001. Some of you may remember the consultation on towards a national ambient noise strategy. And here, the government at the time said, we want to have a noise strategy. Partly the reason for that was there was an air quality strategy. And I think, arguably slightly naively, there was some thought in some quarters you could just cross out the word air quality, insert the word noise, and you'd got a noise strategy. So a few technical advisors had to say, well, it's probably a little bit more complicated than that. And so this three-phase approach was proposed, quantify the situation, which was noise mapping they were talking about even then. Evaluate, identify options, and then agree what needs to be done to move towards the outcome, which was the strategy. And a year later, there was an announcement made in Parliament, and it actually didn't summarise the responses. That was in a separate document. And of that consultation, as you can see, 89% of people supported an ambient noise strategy. Now, ambient at that time meant sort of transport noise. I'll use it very loosely. Because 84% also wanted a neighbour noise strategy, which there had been no mention about. And so this announcement said that the people would push forward with the ambient strategy, but there would be some study to look at neighbour noise. Well, that was a very bold decision to make. Unfortunately, it didn't totally take into account what was happening at the same time. Well, this is a sort of benefit of hindsight. Because in July 2002, about 6 months before that announcement, the Environmental Noise Directive came into law. And the rule was, actually, we should have transposed it into legislation in 2 years. In fact, it was about 2 years late getting into legislation. And it is an awful lot of work to transpose EC directives into law. We also had to think about getting on with noise mapping for round one, because we had to report the results by December 2007. And even though it was 5 years, it's surprising how long it can take to do that. At the same time, out with the noise team, there was the move to move from planning policy guidance to planning policy statements. And PPG 24 got onto the radar as, oh, this ought to be changed into a PPS. And so there was work having to be done on that. And that, although it's led by the department that worried about planning, that's currently communities and local government, their predecessor. I think it was the office of the Deputy Prime Minister in those days. They knew nothing about noise, so they looked to the DEFRA team to help them. So, OK, we'll add that to the to-do list. But the DEFRA team also looks after the nuisance legislation, and not just noise nuisance, but everything under the Environmental Protection Act, Section 79. And there was a move to extend the regime to cover artificial lights and insects. And there was the move to extend the Noise Act to cover licensed premises, both of those two appearing in the Clean Neighbourhoods and Environment Act, which eventually came out in 2005. So there was quite a large to-do list that really wasn't also preparing an ambient noise strategy and preparing and doing something on neighbour noise. Now, because I vaguely recalled this, when I was putting this talk together, I thought, I'm sure there were the occasional parliamentary question about what was going on. And the next few slides will just show how the narrative worked out in that decade, what announcements were made in Parliament and what comments were made about the noise strategy. The debate about, or a debate about, the Clean Neighbourhoods and Environment Act in February 2005 did have a comment by Adam Michael, the then relevant minister, to say, amongst other things, government is committed to developing noise strategies. Notice the plural, so we've got ambient and neighbourhood. There is current research aimed at producing pioneering guidance to local authorities. I love the language. And that actually is the thing that emerged as a noise management guide, which you might remember from about 2006. And then the development of ambient noise strategy is underway. And I quite like that comment towards the end of that first box. I have seen some of the work going on, and the scientists and technologists involved. It is very complicated, but very impressive. Well, it's always good to impress a minister. And of course, if you remember when we first saw noise maps, boy, didn't they look good with all those coloured pictures and lines and things. Very impressive. And of course, it didn't, you know, it was looked good from an MP's point of view. But about the following year, about 15 months later, a question was asked, what steps are being taken to decrease noise pollution? You get these questions come up periodically. I suspect they get primed by some of the pressure groups. I haven't quite worked out the genesis of them all. And so the answer, in order to provide a more strategic approach to management of the noise environment, DEFRA is currently developing a noise strategy. Notice it's gone back down to the singular again. May 2007, again about the timing, and the answer was the government planned to issue a combined national noise strategy covering both environmental and neighbour noise by the end of 2007. They'd come together now as opposed to having separate strategies, which was, I think, a logical thing to do. And it wasn't even DEFRA ministers who had to answer this, because questions were then put to the Department of Health minister. And effectively, it was about the ad hoc group, which some of you might remember, met and produced the report that ultimately got published by Public Health England. It was the one that Andy Morehouse at Salford ended up doing all the editing, and people like Bernard Berry and Ian Flindell and all the usual suspects contributed to. And when talking about that ad hoc group providing a report, they said the results of that will feed into the DEFRA noise strategy for England, which was a phrase I'd only come across when I was doing the research for this for this talk. 2008, again in January, another question, this time to DEFRA, and that's National Noise Strategy for England phrase, covering ambient and neighbourhood noise later this year. Now, if we think about 2008, what was going on there? Well, the activity for doing the round one noise mapping had sort of peaked in 2007. There was a jaw-dropping quantity of work that had to be done. And we were feeling our way as well. I mean, I don't think we really knew what we were doing. I think we got round two a lot better, although I would say that because I was quite closely involved in it. Work had to then get underway regarding publishing the results, and you might recall the Noise Mapping England website, which I think is still functioning, even though it's showing the round one results. We then had to think about developing the noise action plans. The directive has a ludicrous timetable of expecting action plans within a year of completing the mapping. That's just not doable, and none of the member states have managed it, not coherently anyway, I don't think, in my view. And then, with this pressure always in the background about what are we going to do about the strategy, the thought was, well, is the action plan an ambient noise strategy? You know, you've measured the noise, it sort of ticked all the boxes of the original intent going back, back 6 years. Of course, I couldn't do a talk on noise without touching on good old wind turbines and amplitude modulation. And of course, there was a question about that, which immediately provoked the answer about the noise strategy for England. Sets out the government's policy on neighbourhood environmental noise. But then very cautiously, thank heavens for that, it will be premature to state whether the strategy will single out aerodynamic modulation of noise of wind turbines. But that was, I thought, quite diverting. And then in June 2008, there was this fantastic question, somebody really probing at it, how obviously somebody had been keeping an eye on this. When did the government start begin consulting on this strategy, and when's it going to be published? And it's the MP for Colchester, I think, Bob Russell, I think he's a Lib Dem, asked that question. Don't forget, we were still in the Labour administration in 2008. And I just love this answer. I'm grateful to the Honourable Gentleman for his question. You know, that's fantastic. And then he talked about he and I were founder members of the All-Party Group on Noise Reduction. And yes, there was such a group. I did end up attending one of those meetings, and then it sort of faded away. And dear old Val gets a nice mention. But then, back on the attack, if you like, since I was appointed to my post, I and my officials have been looking into the matter. He will be aware that we published the noise maps on which the department did a huge amount of work. And then, I like the boasting, this was one of the largest IT projects ever undertaken, which I think was true when we were sort of casting around what was going on. And it was successfully achieved. Well, we got the results out and we reported to Europe, so that's true. And then I love the way he claimed the credit. I was the minister responsible and it worked. It all went very well, which reminded me terribly of Mr. Grace. And we must concentrate on the noise strategy, and I hope I will be able to bring it forward within a year. So that was within a year of June 2008. There was yet further questions on the timing, and it said it's going to happen later this year and so on. And then we moved to October 2009, when there was yet another question about when was a neighbourhood noise strategy first proposed and when it's likely to be published. And this point, I think there was a very pragmatic, straightforward answer, and it actually was an honest answer. And if we look at the sort of key things it said, it goes right back to December 2002, the announcement. The subsequent view then, rather having two strategies, we would combine them into one. And that the single strategy would address environmental, neighbour and neighbourhood noise. Now, those of you who know their noise policy might recognise that phrase. It will become clear why that appeared there. But then, the answer then said, but in 2002 we had the Environmental Noise Directive, it had to be the main focus of activity. So, it was actually saying what the reason was. We couldn't do a strategy because we had to deal with the directive. And that there we are now progressing noise action plans. And the government are in the process of consolidating for all sources the longer term management policies, some of which are to be found in the noise action plans. So, what was happening in 2009? Well, just before then, 2008, the consultation on the guidance to airport operators for doing their action plans started. March 2009, there was the initial consultation about the other action plans. They were the ones for agglomerations and major roads and major railways. March 2009 saw the publication of the airport guidance, so the airports then could get on and start developing their action plan. In July 2009, the main action plan consultation started, and there was a roadshow that I remember we did around the country as part of the consultation process. And then in 2009, I had to look it up, we started work on the noise policy statement for England. And it's because the phrase environmental neighbour and neighbourhood noise, we'd already sort of thought we ought to sort of split it up a bit. That's why it appeared in that parliamentary answer a month or so later. So March 2010, I suspect, I'm sure this happens, I don't know for certain in this case, that somebody was asked to ask the question, what is the Secretary of State to DEFRA, what steps the department is taking to tackle noise nuisance, to provide a platform then to announce the noise policy statement for England. The government recognised that the management of noise, all the usual stuff, that is why the DEFRA published the noise policy statement for England this week, etc., etc. And then a curious thing that I found, to ask the Secretary of State for DEFRA what recent representations he has received on the MPSC. Now, the answer said no representations, and that was my recollection as well. But interesting, it just spelt out a bit more about the process and how it says DEFRA officials met with all the relevant government departments, including a number of key external stakeholders, ranging in interests from industry to non-governmental organisations, who expressed broad support for it. And I was part of that meeting with people, and that's very much the impression that we got as well, that, that people sort of got it. The maybe no representations, but not long after the MPSC was published, there was this article in the Independent newspaper, which I pulled out just three quotes from it. The one that we've spoken about, DEFRA has spoken about in the past, is the first paragraph, where it says official policy statements from Whitehall tend to be bland and full of sincere sounding generalities, but just now and then something important, perhaps even revolutionary, can be glimpsed in their pages. I thought that's quite an interesting comment to make about the MPSC. the second bullet point, the publication of the MPSC will make it more difficult even for government departments to get away with that kind of trickery. The article had made reference to an issue over wind turbines and the reports that DEC had published and whether the final version reflected the draft. You might remember there was some issue over Hayes McKenzie report around about that time. And then the third bullet point, I only picked that up having reread it, preparing for this talk. Indeed, it should influence many of the most significant proposed changes to our national life over the next decade. Well, I'm not sure quite we can claim that yet, but I think it's there and thereabouts. Again, I thought that's quite interestingly perceptive by the author. So, March 2010, the MPSC existed, and at least it attracted one newspaper item. But of course, we then had the election in May 2010. And I think a lot of credit needs to go to the policy official in DEFRA at the time, because this question came in from one of the usual suspects who asked questions, what's the government doing about noise? I'm sure they must work with one of the NGOs, I don't know who it is. And the answer was put up, the MPSC provides the wide framework, et cetera, and went on about END and noise action plans. And the simple fact that that question was answered nailed the MPSC as part of coalition policy. Whereas if people wanted to get picky over it, you know, so, well, has this government really approved it and all the rest of it? Well, within a month of the government coming in, or perhaps less than a month of the coalition being formed, the Noise Policy Statement for England had been established as coalition policy. And I think that was quite good. And I actually went to a meeting with one of the ministers later on, when they were sort of feeling their way a bit. And I said, well, I understand we've got this policy that we've borrowed from the other lot. I can remember that phrase. But we've gone along with it. And we said, yes, sir, that's right. End of story. And that was it. The policy was there and had the traction. So that's how it evolved. And it was all because there was this drive for a strategy. And what actually happened is at one point somebody said to me, and Colin Grimwood was there at the time, I need a strategy. And we said, well, actually, don't you need a policy before you have a strategy, because you need to know what you're trying to achieve before you write down how you're going to achieve it. All right, then, give me a policy. And that was it. And you can see how that evolved. So I confess I quite enjoyed doing that, because I had this vague recollection of what went on. But actually, and it's all out online. This is, now, I've given no secrets away. You can go onto the web and find out all that information that I've just presented. So, I guess Many of you will be familiar with this, I hope you are. This is the noise policy statement for England. 2 pages of policy, 4 pages of explanatory notes, and possibly to the chagrin of some acousticians, there's no mention of a decibel. But then do you actually need decibels in a policy per se? And there are the key elements, the heart of the policy, the vision, and the aims. The first two bullet points of the aims, I actually think, well, didn't change what we've been doing. It's effectively saying we will deal with not nice noise, bad noise, noise that adversely affects people. I'm using noise loosely, please forgive me. I know I should worry about sound and noise, but it's easier for this purpose. What was new was the third bullet point, the where possible contribute to the improvement of health and quality of life, i.e. this is sound management, you know, Peter's very keen on this, using the management of what we colloquially know as noise, actually possibly to, Colin Grimmer uses a nice phrase, positive acoustic environment. That's what we're, you know, trying to achieve. It's there, it's in policy. But crucially with the policy, there is extremely careful use of language. Promote good health, not achieve, because that would be silly, because you'd never get that, but promote, i.e. try and make it going in the right direction. Good, not perfect, but not too bad. It, again, deliberately done like that. Management, it's not just about reducing the number of decibels. There are other things that affect how we perceive, react to noise. So it's about the management. That's why that all-party committee that they mentioned earlier, I think, was poorly named, because it was the all-party noise reduction committee. I'd far prefer noise management committee, and if we get enthusiastic about that, that's the name I would suggest we try and give it. And then the balance in the context of government policy and sustainable development. Now, that really was the key to getting traction with those departments whose policy have to try and build roads and build railways and do things which might impact on the noise environment. I don't think this is an exaggeration, but I perceived it certainly 10 years ago that those of us who worried about noise were sandal-wearing hippies and didn't get what the real world was about. And we had to work hard to say, look, we do get what the real world's about, but we still have to manage the noise. It didn't go down terribly well with this because one journalist has said, and I'm sure you can all guess who that might be, regular readers of this newsletter, there's another clue, will be well aware that we have a serious problem with DEFRA's love affair with the phrase in the context of sustainable development. But the point about it is that it is a balance. The phrase 2.1 in the explanatory noise is an inevitable consequence of a mature and vibrant society. That almost got quoted in Hansard, actually, on a debate that got involved in about 2009-10, but the minister didn't like vibrant and put a mature and evolving society, I think he ordered it to. Well, so the same thing. But the crucial thing is, the policy says you've got to think about the value to society of what the noise-making activity is doing, and that's where the balance comes in. If it is no real value, well, I'm sorry, bang to rights, you can't get on with it. But if there is value, there is a balance to be struck. But as you'll see later on, there are limits. When we eventually get to the planning practice guidance, you see actually almost no matter what the value to society is, there is a line in the sand. Back to the words again. Once again, on the aims, it's a void. It doesn't mean not have. Policy allows there to be a significant adverse impact. Now, you do your best not to have it, and it really ought to be the exception, but there's nothing in policy that says you can't have a significant adverse impact. And then you've got mitigate and minimise. I was challenged at one point about whether that was tautological, and that got me thinking. But actually, I think it's probably all right, because mitigate means be seen to be trying to do something. Minimise means to get it as low as possible in the context, etc., etc. I think there are two actions, And if push comes to shove, you can talk about that. And then, crucially, again, it's in the context. Now, it trying to word it so it didn't get too repetitive was difficult, but it's important that context is there. And you'll see later on, as this policy permeated other government policies, the language slipped a bit. And those of you who have given expert evidence will know how barristers latch on to every single word. And if it suits their case to twist the intent, they will do so. And this, I think, the policy works, but how it's got through to some of the other documents, I think there are one or two holes. And there's a couple of examples which I can mention later on. So that's the heart of it. Now, there are other bits in the six-page document, as I've touched on already, a definition of environmental neighbour and neighbourhood noise. These aren't hard and fast, and we could probably have a 20-minute debate about whether we've got things in the right category. But it sort of reflects how we currently think about noise and how the legislation currently works. So, environmental noise, transportation noise, that's sort of done in one great heap. I mean, the directive does confuse things by throwing in industry as well. And I and DEFRA have gone public saying we think industry should drop out of the directive because it just doesn't fit. Whether it will or not, I have to wait and see. Neighbour noise from inside and outside people's homes, that's something you really can tackle through the Environmental Protection Act. That's where those powers exist. And obviously, inside is where the building regulations and sound insulation issues come in. And then neighbourhood noise are also issues that primarily can be tackled through the Environmental Protection Act, which you can't really tackle with environmental noise. So I know you might say, well, construction sites are environmental noise. Wind farms. Now, that, to my mind, is neighbourhood. All right, it's possibly quite a large neighbourhood, but it's still neighbourhood because the dynamic of how you tackle it is similar to other issues. There are some statements in the explanatory note and in the MPSC that I think are very important and sometimes can get forgotten in day-to-day life. And I would commend, if you're struggling with it, I'm not quite sure how to tackle this problem, go back to this. It doesn't take long to read, and I think there'll be a clue. So, the first one provides a necessary clarity and direction to enable decisions to be made about what is an acceptable noise burden to place on society. I've had slight second thoughts about whether acceptable, I don't really like acceptable as a word. What's acceptable to whom? But if you read any of the HS2, so I've got time on my hand, I've read some of the HS2 transcripts from when Rupert's been appearing in front of the Select Committee. And the word acceptable comes up almost all the time. It's the favoured word of barristers. But I think this is the one time it appears in the policy. And provides clarity regarding current policies and practices. Now, I think some of you who like using numbers and say, oh, it mustn't be above 65, I'll get it below 65, I've done the job. It doesn't provide that sort of clarity, but it does provide clarity of what we are trying to achieve in terms of the outcome, if you think about the aims. And this phrase about makes explicit what's implicit in the underlying principles. Now, that actually doesn't appear in the policy. I can remember the civil servant who came up with it. And said, well, what you're sort of saying, we're making explicit what's implicit. That's it. That's exactly what we're doing. But in the end, it didn't make it. But actually, if you go to the archive webpage when the policy is announced, you can see that in the text of the archive webpage. So it's legitimate for me to quote it here, because I think it does do that. And one of the points about that is that we haven't, or the policy didn't change what went on before. And you will see in some things that have happened since then. Noise policy, it's a new policy. No, it might be a new policy statement, but the policy didn't change. Because if you think about it, always, certainly throughout my career, we've tried to avoid it being, I use a colloquial language, really horrible, avoid significant adverse impact. We've tried to minimise as far as possible when it's not nice. Mitigate and minimise adverse impact. That's what we've done, that's what I've done all my working life. The MPSC writes down what we're doing, and it didn't change policy. So if you hear anybody say the MPSC changed what went on before, the answer is no. And it says so in these explanatory notes and so on. By having a clear policy, one of the thoughts was in DEFRA that when other government departments were doing something that couldn't muck about with the noise environment, because one of the dynamics is that although DEFRA has policy responsibility, it has none of the levers. Because DFT look after all transport, CLG, communities and local government, look after planning, DCMS, culture, media and sport, deal with licensing, DEC, deal with wind farms, yet DEFRA is irresponsible for noise. The thought process was, have you demonstrate to us, DEFRA, that you're complying with the noise policy statement, and throw the onus back onto the promoting department, if you like. Means then you can get noise thought about right at the start, as opposed to what I think happened before then. Oh, goodness me, haven't thought about the noise on this. Doesn't always work, mind you, but that was the intention. Not consider noise in isolation. I think there is a risk with the Environmental Noise Directive that you could read that and get terribly enthusiastic and think that noise is the most important issue that Europe's got to tackle. Well, clearly it isn't. It is an important issue, but it's not the most important issue. And there is a bit of tension, I think, there, because the directive gives no hint about striking the balance, what's the value of the noise-making activity. You just see lots of numbers about how many people have 65 dB outside their front door. Our policy, MPSE, says don't treat it in isolation. And then an important point, again, you might argue it's not clear because there are no numbers, but it says the MPSE provides the necessary clarity wherever current policy is unclear or ambiguous, or where there is doubt about the government's intended outcome. There is no doubt. The policy says this is what you've got to achieve. If you're not sure, go back. And what the MPSE should have done, although, as you will see towards the end of the talk, hasn't quite achieved yet, is the phrase that I'm sure we've all written, there are no standards that apply to this particular situation. Therefore, I'm going to, I'll use BS4142, because that always seems to be the answer. That is now not so. The policy applies literally to every noise situation that we tackle. There might be no numbers, but you know what you've got to achieve. Avoid significant adverse impact, mitigate and minimise adverse, and where possible, improve. So there's no justification for writing that anymore. Because the MPSE says what we've got to do. Who should implement? Well, it's everybody who might do something that could affect the noise environment. So clearly it's government, clearly it's local authorities. Other bodies, think airports, they affect the noise environment. Airports should behave with the noise policy in their background. And anybody else who's going to fiddle around with something that could affect the acoustic environment. And it's not just noise coming from outside, you know, transportation, neighbour, sound insulation, all the rest of it. Here's an interesting thought, I've just off the top of my head. What sound insulation causes a significant adverse impact? I'll leave that one to ponder on. We don't know the answer to that yet. I don't know the answer. But it would apply. The MPSE applies to that. And the building regulations are how you implement the policy. So, we had the MPSE published in March 2010. I joined DEFRA as a civil servant in January 2011. And that, suddenly I lost you're a nasty, horrible consultant who's just here to rip us off of all our money that we've earned, and you don't do any work and we don't trust you. I did go to a meeting once when a civil servant said, what's he doing here? He's a consultant. But fortunately my policy colleague said, yeah, but he does actually know a bit about what we're talking about, so can he stay? Oh, all right then. Do come in, you're welcome. Do you want to come to this meeting about this, that and the other? It was amazing. Yeah, suddenly all these, I had far too many doors open that I could possibly go through, but the whole thing turned around. And I was there, and Hilary Notley, who some of you will know, who's still there, we had this little team, being able to answer questions like, what is a decibel then? What's this A mean? And it was like that. It, you know, they people and all sorts of policy areas, suddenly noise appeared. And because we had the MPSC, at least we had a hook to say, okay, well, this is where we start from. And, you know, the June 2010 parliamentary question gave it authority. One of the first policy areas actually occurred before I joined, but as the MPSC was sort of coming together. And that were the noise policy statements supporting nationally significant infrastructure projects, NSIPs. They love the acronyms. And this came as a result of the Planning Act 2008. Now, that still exists today. And those of you who have been involved in development control order type projects, it's all emerging under the Planning Act, and they are increasing in number now. You can go onto the website and see how many are kicking around. One of the early ones was the Hinkley Point Nuclear Power Station, where that is done under a DCO. Thames Tideway, which I'll touch on a bit later, that's done under a DCO. Various road schemes and all the new road schemes that the Highways England have announced, many of those will be done through this process as well. It originally talked about this Infrastructure Planning Commission. That was under the Labour administration, but then it moved to the Planning Inspectorate. And one of the purposes of this was to try and avoid debates at public inquiry being about the wisdom of the policy. I'll pause on that and I'll pick it up later on when we get to one of the relevant issues. But the other idea was that it's supposed to be non-adversarial. So as opposed to one barrister, another barrister, cross-examination, you just have this panel who ask the various experts and petitioners questions, and they then form the view. They're now, the phrase for them is now the examining authority. So they're the people who sit in judgment and produce the report. And they are, though for these types of projects, they're the people who sit in judgment on it and make the recommendation. There are quite a host of these NSIPs. They all have sort of thresholds, which you'd have to sort of delve into the back of the Planning Act to find. But you can see things like generating stations, electric lines, gas reception facilities, gas transporters. The second page, highways, airports, harbours, railways, an awful lot of the stuff that a lot of us get involved with. And to help implementation of this, there are 12 national policy statements. Actually, we've only got 10 at the moment, but there are 12 planned. The first six were all to do with energy, as listed there, and that was led by the Department for Energy and Climate Change, and they were all designated in July 2011. So that was after the election, after the noise policy came in. Then there was one on ports, January 2012, one on transport networks, which is at the beginning of this year. It's called National Networks, is its formal title. There's one likely to come on aviation, but it depends on what Davis comes up with. But the understanding is that if Davis says there ought to be a new runway, there might be a national policy statement about the rules of the game for that new runway. But whether that happens or not, I don't know. And obviously they were led by Department for Transport. And then we've got wastewater and hazardous waste, designated 2012-2013. DEFRA is a lead for department for that. There's potentially one on water supply, but nothing around I've seen on that at all, so I don't know whether that's going to happen or not. Now, if we dip into these in a bit more detail, I thought I could skip over these, and I've done that in talks in the past, but actually I think we're going to give the full story. There are some interesting things to pick up from this, and hopefully, you know, if you suddenly find yourself doing one of these things, you'll know where to look to find the guidance. There's an overarching energy MPS, EN1. There's quite a good section, I think, on noise and vibration at section 5.11. And in point one, immediately, there's a link to the MPSC at the end of that first paragraph. So that ties this MPS or the noise bit anyway, into that. The crucial thing always to look out for is, what is the test? What is the decision maker got to think about? And in this case, you will see there are some familiar words there in the bullet points. And the decision maker should not grant development consent unless. It's not quite the same as the MPSE. Can you see where it's different? Well, to save you struggling on that, the first thing that is not there is in the context of government policy on sustainable development. But if I go forward, earlier on in the overarching MPS, it says all of this has got to be in the context of sustainable development. So there's the link back. But the other thing that happened, and this just shows the serendipity nature of life, notice that the third bullet point says, where possible, contribute to improvements to health and quality of life. In one of the original drafts, there then was a gap, and through the effective management and control of noise was a separate line unbulleted. In the final production, that gap got lost. And so a literal reading of that has no clue at all how we're supposed to avoid significant adverse impact or mitigate and minimise adverse impacts. But where possible, we will do it through the effective management of noise. Is that important? Don't know. The crucial thing is that if you're aware that it's not quite the same, the MPSE says, if in doubt, go back and look what the original document says. And then it's absolutely clear what that is supposed to mean. Now, I've not heard of anybody making mischief out of that, but it's the sort of thing to be aware of, and, you know, so immensely irritating when that slips through. The rest of the suite of energy MPSs rely heavily on EN1, but then sort of shade it according to the type of issue. So, on fossil fuel, there's quite a lot of mention of the sort of things that might be noise sources for that. And then, again, it talks about what the tests are and so on. And there is the link to 511 of EN1, should consider the noise impacts according to section 511, and then should not grant development consent. So, again, there's consistency within the ENs and through EN1 link back to the MPSE. Now, EN3, some of you might have dealt with, because that picks up large wind turbines developments. Again, there is the link to EN1, but good old EFSU gets a mention in the heart of EN3, and it says this should, not only that, but then there's also in 2756, not only use ETSU, but take account of industry good practice. It should include any guidance on best practice that the government may from time to time publish. Now, that's where the good practice guide of the IoA gets its hook. That's through that clause in EN3 that enabled DEC to say, we sanction, endorse, I forget the word now, of the IoA's good practice guidance on assessing wind turbine noise. So that's the policy link, that's the audit trail. If you like, on that. Section 4 is not quite so exciting. It's gas, underground natural gas storage, but again, you can see the links. And there it says the decision maker should follow the principles for decision making without being sort of so overt. And then there's also gas and oil pipelines, and the same sort of thing occurs. Electricity networks, again, is a slightly different one. EN1 gets the reference. There's also the information about the sources. And in fact, Simon might remember this, that Bernard, where's Simon gone? Lost him. Bernard did some work on this, you might remember, about the overhead cable line when we were at BV and looking at and advising on that. This is where the fruits of his labour appeared in this particular one. But what's quite interesting is uniquely, I think, amongst any of these, it tells you what the answer is likely to be. Where the applicant can demonstrate that appropriate mitigation measures will be put in place, the residual noise impacts are unlikely to be significant. Now, again, arguably not quite the right use of language. Consequently, noise from overhead lines is unlikely to lead to the decision maker refusing the application. Now, that's the only example I've found where the NPS actually says, if you get it remotely right, chaps, you shouldn't have a noise issue that will get in the way of promoting your overhead cable. The odd one of all this is nuclear power generation. And I think actually one of the drivers for this whole suite of policies was the question of what do we do about nuclear power. And as I said earlier, one of the purposes of the Planning Act and the NPSs is to try and get rid of the debate about shall we or shall we not have nuclear power, but okay, we're going to have it. More to the point, we're going to have it here. And then the debate is how best to build it. And there was a huge consultation about where nuclear power might reside and so on. And as I mentioned earlier, Hinkley has got produced on that. I heard on the news the other day there's some issue about EDF may not being able to afford it or something. But even on this one, with a slightly different layout, EN1 gets a mention regarding noise impacts. I should put decision maker there. But notice there's a slightly different test. The decision maker will not grant development consent unless it's satisfied that all reasonable steps have been taken to minimise noise impact. Consistency got lost there. I genuinely don't recall ever being asked about EN6. I don't think this ever went through DEFRA. And almost that's all old-fashioned language. It sounds like PPG24, really, isn't it? Do your best to minimise, which is not what the policy says, and it's actually not totally consistent with what EN1 says. That's, I think, quite interesting. And again, you can't assume that the language is the same because these things happen. Moving on to wastewater, this is again has the familiar words you can see, and it's also a should not grant. The through the effective point got carried over because they tend, once you've got a model, these things tend to roll across different departments and just not picked up in the detail. And also the in the context point again isn't there, but it's further to the front of the NPS. Hazardous waste, well, again, the same sort of thing, should not grant, looks very similar. But when we go to ports, which is a DFT document, look at the test. The test is slightly different. The decision maker should be satisfied that proposals will meet, which is not as strong a test as should not grant unless. Just the way it went, really. But it's worth noting that should you find yourself doing a port. And then national networks, which is the most recent one. Again, it all looks very similar. It's a should not grant, so even though it's a DFT document, it's the same sort of hard line as the other ones. But also, notice that the within the context of government policy and sustainable development is there in 5.195, that bit of the policy. And there is a sort of alignment with what happened with Thames Tideway. Now, Thames Tideway, which is the sewage tunnel in London, basically, which, as the name suggests, I think is going to run along the tidal bit of the Thames, at least underneath it. It relied on the wastewater NPS. And in the examining authority report, you could gain the impression that they'd not recognised the in-the-context point. And in the decision letter from government, it made it clear, in reaching this view, Secretary of State have considered wider government policy on noise. Well, that's good, because that's what the NPSE says. The National Planning Policy Framework, the National Planning Practice Guidance on Noise, and the National Policy Statement for England are all clear that noise management should be determined in the context of sustainable development, including environmental, etc., etc. And the circle was closed, because if the in the context point had been mentioned at the crucial bit, it's this reading bits in isolation, not the whole document, that issue wouldn't have arisen. And the fact it's now in the national networks one means, I think, that if anybody works on any other national policy statement and somebody tries to treat noise in isolation, you've got the decision letter from Thames Tideway along with the MPSC to say, actually, we are supposed to do this. So I think that's actually helped move policy forward a bit, and just to get it a little bit more balanced. As I said right when I started on the NSIPs and the MPSs, they are formally part of planning policy, and they are mentioned in the National Planning Policy Framework. They talk about there are the MPPF doesn't have the policies for NSIPs, but there are the relevant national policy statements. So although you might think that the National Planning Policy Framework is the overarching planning document, which it probably is, there's a clear trail through to the national policy statements, and it says national policy statements form part of the overall framework. So they are important, and if you've not caught up with them, I mean, this hopefully will have given you a bit of a steer to it, and especially, you know, is the project you're working on, does it trigger the Planning Act, is it going to go to the DCO, then the rules are in the national policy statements rather than the MPPF, although there's a lot of similarity. Now, I'm guessing that this will be very familiar to you, paragraph 123 of the National Planning Policy Framework. As you can then see, the first two bullet points, very, very similar wording to the MPSC, not quite the same, rather irritating, reduced to a minimum. Is that different from minimise? You know, discuss? I don't know. And then the other two bullet points, the third one was this sort of pro-business, don't muck up existing businesses by letting development encroach on them. That wording, I think, if one wanted to be mischievous, you could cause a little bit of trouble with. It's a since they were established point, I think. Oh, is that really? Do they really mean that? But then the fourth one was the thing that sort of came from left field and suddenly put tranquility into the policy. And that got our friends at CPRE terribly excited. And Graham Willis said, you know, latches onto that all the time. Well, there it is in government policy. There are some footnotes, which again I'm sure you're familiar with. One ties it to the MPSC, and the other one says, you know, all right, but don't forget, once you put housing near to industry, the industry is vulnerable to the Environmental Protection Act, so don't think you can get away with it. But of course, the MPPF also has these nice things about sustainable development design. I'm thinking of Peter when I mentioned this. You know, it's all about good design. And there's a whole raft of opportunity in trying to push for good design where you can link it. I think it's these two paragraphs of the MPSC, the MPPF that can help with that. And then there's paragraph 109, which at first you thought, what on earth does this mean? What does being put at unacceptable risk from unacceptable levels of all these things? Well, you can sort of see what they're saying, but suddenly noise of pollution appeared in there. So you had noise seemingly nicely tucked in 123, and all of a sudden it features in 109 as well. But actually, it's quite useful, as you will see later, in my blog, some of you might be familiar with already. Now, when the MPPF came out and cries of anguish went up from the acoustics community that the security blanket of PPG24 had disappeared, some people observed, well, hang on a minute, if you're on minerals, all the numbers are still there, which of course they were, and they still are, in fact. Paragraph 123 talks about preparing local plans and what to do about minerals, take account of adverse or unacceptable adverse impacts on human health, including noise. When developing noise limits, recognise that some noisy short-term activities, which may otherwise be regarded as unacceptable, are unavoidable. So, broadly, it's the usual stuff. Any of you who've done minerals work will recognise it. And talks about trying to deal with noise at source and establishing appropriate noise limits. And then gives a footnote 21, which references to this technical guidance that came out at the same time as the MPPF. And in paragraphs 28 to 31, It's almost a direct copy from the old mineral planning statement too, those of you who are familiar with that. So we had this sort of curious dichotomy. On the one hand, we'd got words and no numbers for almost everything, but then we'd got real numbers for minerals. And as far as I know, we still have that. So if you're doing minerals, technical guidance, you've got numbers. I think it's good old 70 and 55, if I remember rightly. Over at DFT, there was the aviation policy framework emerging. There'd been the air transport white paper in about 2002-03-ish. 10 years on, another one. And there's a clear policy objective in there. Want to limit and, where possible, reduce the number of people in the UK significantly affected by aircraft noise. And an overt statement consistent with government noise policy is set out in the MPSE. So what this has done is picked out the first bullet point and said, this is the policy that we're going to use, use for aviation. A word of caution, if you get involved in this, there is a possible significant muddle. Because, as was said in the Air Transport White Paper, it says we will continue to treat the 57, 16-hour Contour as the approximate onset of significant community annoyance. It's not the same significant. Now, if you go back through the audit trail, you can see what happened, because the phrase originally was onset of community annoyance. Well, you can imagine that anybody distracted by aircraft noise who lived in this 56 Contour, who found themselves annoyed, hang on a minute, you say I'm not annoyed, yet I am annoyed, this can't be right. And the word significant was added to mean that's when it starts to get really sort of interesting from an annoyance point of view. Because that is not the same significant as significantly adversely affected, because I'm sure if you spoke to DFT, they wouldn't think 57 as a significant adverse impact. And if you look at the proportion of people affected, you're sitting at the 10, 11, 12% of the community highly annoyed at that, which I don't think is significant. You need about the 63, 66, 69s to start getting it really interesting. So there's a little bit of significance, a dreadful word. We've used it in the policy, I know, but it's just, you've got to think about it. Not all significants are the same. I won't try and say some are more significant than others. That would be just dreadful. Funny enough, the Environmental Noise Directive Action Plans is quite well wedded to the noise policy statement, given it came from the same stable. And this is just an extract from the plan that was published in January 2014, following the round two mapping. In line with the government's policy on noise, absolutely nailed it, aims to promote good health, etc., etc. Also, it's got the context of sustainable development point in there as well. And what the highway authorities in this case have to do is examine their important areas and see what more might be taken to assist with the implementation of government's policy of noise, i.e. to avoid significant adverse impacts, mitigate and minimise, and I guess where possible improve, though I suspect the scope for that is limited. Airports have to do their own action plans. There is government guidance on that. This document came out in 2013. It just updated the previous one. And there you can see familiar phrases, the three bullet points, and so on. So, again, all the action plan activity very firmly linked to the noise policy statement. So there is consistency. There was this huge fuss after the NPPF came out about additional noise guidance. We need more. And Lord Matthew Taylor chaired a what's described as a small practitioners group to review the need for further guidance. And this report came out December 2012, so about 9 months after the NPPF was published. And much to our delight, tucked away in Annex D under the heading Environmental Quality, there was a need for further guidance on noise. So that's good, we're going to get some further guidance. The Taylor Review also talked about what he thought the guidance should be. So, for example, it should help the effective delivery of plan making and decision taking. Now, if you remember the MPPF, you've got these sort of two sides to it. It's how local authorities make their plans, and it's how local authorities take decisions. So plan making, decision taking, you can see that theme there. What they said is they should not necessarily repeat statutes and regulations. So quite a lot of the text that was in PPT 24, Taylor used, we don't need that. You know, that's known elsewhere. It also said that it should exclude best practice exemplar type information, which is better provided by practitioner bodies. So that got the IoA quite excited when they saw there might be an opportunity to do something like that. Taylor also said, let's get modern web-based resource, constantly update. There were concerns, I think they probably still exist, about what is the date of the guidance, at least with PPT 24. Old data had a physical document, you knew what was in there. And if any of you, and if you don't do that, I would commend sign up to the updates to the planning practice guidance, and you get these random emails that says, oh, we've updated this guidance, and you have to work through it carefully, but at least you know if it's changed. And there's nothing to control it changing. You might be in the middle of a public inquiry and the guidance will change. And I haven't actually found written down what do you do in that circumstances. I suspect you just have to come to some form of agreement. But do sign up to that. Although it encouraged not to put exemplar in the document, it did say you should signpost, or the guidance should signpost best practice to others. The government response came out about 4 or 5 months later, and it said we accept the majority of the recommendations, with the exception of signposting. I have no idea why that was, but that was the government response. So there was then the need to produce this planning practice guidance. And in the end, partly because it was done as a series of questions, as I guess you know, it was trying to write down what are the sort of things that a consultant working for a developer ought to think about when assessing the impact, what a local authority should think about when reviewing the impact, just to make sure the right questions were asked. Again, some people don't like this. It doesn't tell you the answer, but it tells you the issues you should think about. And I think it's been quite successful in doing that. If you've not got there, that's where you find the web page, what it should look like if you get to the planning practice guidance. What was interesting was there was a change between the draft. It was sort of a beta version. The original intent was it was really sort of practicing the functionality of the website, because it ended up it being sort of an informal consultation on the planning practice guidance. There were no cross-references whatsoever, and quite a large demand for that, I think quite a lot from the acoustic and the IoA community. In the final version, you'll see references to other documents where there is helpful information about how to do things, but they're all sort of under the government umbrella, so the minerals technical guidance, the aviation policy framework, the ETSU, and all the national policy statements. Interestingly, of course, now we've got national networks. This document needs to be updated to include national networks, which I noticed when I was putting this together. Whether that will happen or not, I don't know. There was some debate about British standards, but one of the problem with British standards, it covers the whole country, as we are very much in England. That's the way we've devolved noise down. I think there's a bit of a debate to have whether all the British standards in the words they use actually comply with the MPSE. And because there was enough ambiguity, it was felt that the S's shouldn't be part of the planning practice guidance. A range of topics, all in the form of questions. I think there's quite a lot of good stuff in this in terms of just what you should do and how you should think about it. And if you've not read it, again, it doesn't take terribly long. I would commend doing so. And because, for example, we've got tranquility mentioned in the MPPF, tranquility has to be mentioned in the planning practice guidance, and there's a sentiment in that. One of the more interesting ones, and as I mentioned right at the start, Can noise override other planning considerations? It can. Now that's a huge statement. Noise could be the killer in terms of a proposal. But it goes on to say, shouldn't consider it in isolation. Effectively it's saying, well, it can cause it to run into the sand, but you have to be pretty naive to let that happen and not to address what would be an unacceptable noise impact, using that terminology. There's a section about what factors influence noise. This is standard acoustic. I mean, it's, although we're not, wasn't supposed to put in how to do things, actually, if you read that, that's not a bad starter for 10 about what you think about as your source, day, night, continuous, non-continuous, intermittent, what's the pattern, what's the spectral content, and all the rest of it. All that's in the planning practice guidance. There's no excuse for ignoring it. If you've got a housing development, say, and external amenity space is important, the acoustic environment of that space ought to be good enough so it can be enjoyed as intended. Not sure whether that's done quite right in the way it's put into effect, I don't know. And then you've got this bit about new residential development being close to existing businesses. And I mentioned about updates. And if you did sign up to that, you would have switched your computer on after the Christmas break. Rather alarming to find you got an email from communities and local government on Christmas Day telling you they'd fiddled around with the planning practice guidance. And those are the changes that happened on that text, where live music venues get overtly mentioned, and this statement about make sure you get appropriate mitigation into development, and this phrase about optimising the sound insulation provided by the new development's building envelope. Another important one, I think, in this, again, this is back to good design, and it's the old sort of acoustic prison point that some people talk about. You know, you might be able to box people into somewhere next to an extremely loud source and get a number inside the property that doesn't challenge BS 823 or 8233 or what you might even think is a low, let alone a soul, should not make for unsatisfactory development. So there is a sort of design caveat. So again, thinking about sustainability design, there is something in the policy guidance that says, hang on a minute, I know theoretically this works, but you know, will it be all right to live there? And then this, I think, again, it was pushing the boundary a bit. It was saying, does this offsetting work? Now, there has been research that you're better off if you've got a quiet facade out of the back and a noisy one out the front than if you've only got a noisy one out of the front. You're better off if you've got a quiet space you can escape to that's yours. You're better off if you haven't got one of those, a quiet space you can escape to that's not too far away. That got into there, which I think is right. Not sure we understand the detail of it, but certainly some of our European colleagues reckon 20 dB front to back is worth having in terms of a quiet facade, and the impact is less bad than if it wasn't there. I've unfortunately heard that there seems to be the odd example of people rather abusing or misusing this statement, but it's there with good intentions. And I think this is one of the things, I think we're going to understand the benefit of quiet more, or having access to quiet. You know, the policy is already there to exploit it. And one of the other things in the guidance, and the thing probably most people will have spotted, is the effects table, where as broadly the level, intensity, the quantity of noise impact increases, what it likely to, how it's likely to affect individuals, and where the sort of LOA L boundary is, where the SOL boundary is, and where unacceptable comes in. That's the paragraph, paragraph 109. Where this came from, some people thought, oh, typical, the English should borrow this from the Scots, because you can find this in the Scottish technical advice note, but actually the Scots had originally nicked it from the English, because you actually go back to one of my papers in 2006, where I was endlessly talking about the at long last published IEMA guidelines, and you will see in that the general principles of that table was something that is now in the IoA guidelines, but we were, you know, people were thinking about back in 2006 and has got itself translated into the planning practice guidance. But of course, there's still no numbers. Can local plans include noise standards? Well, again, it says, yes, they can. Work together, work out what's suitable for you. And, you know, the arguments, there's no right answer to this, but the argument for local plans and local people doing it is, are the limits you should have in Cornwall the same as the limits you should have in Birmingham? Well, some might say, of course they should be, and others might say, no, Birmingham's different from Cornwall and the rest of it. Conversely, some say, yeah, but if I am a national developer, I like to know that hoops I've got to jump through in Cornwall are the same as the hoops I've got to jump through in Birmingham. And actually, that was one of the rationales for the POP code all those years ago, that promoters knew that what they had to do, that we use Northumberland as the example then. So you can see there is this distinction. Now, at the moment, the political mood is local people decide. And there's still quite a lot of that if you've been listening to the election now. Where I think we as a profession let ourselves down is that we've spent hours, and I've been involved in it, I guess you have as well, at public inquiries arguing over 0.1 of a decibel. No, it's all right, I'm at 65.9. No, you're not, you're at 66.1. I'll come off it, it's no difference. The policy says, think about the effect. Actually, you're talking about nonsense now. And that phrase about avoid these being implemented as fixed threshold, as circumstances may justify some variation being allowed. So it's quite clear. So if you find yourself with a local authority with numbers, you've got the policy there to say, oh yeah, but actually you may say 35, but I can bring it in at 36. That's all right, isn't it? You have got the hook to have that sort of argument. Which brings us nicely on to examples of use. You'll be glad to know there's not too many of these. HS2, a very modest environmental statement. I think there's a document, I've spoken to Richard Greer about this, I think there's a document that navigates you through the documents. It's so huge, it's quite a challenge. I can't say this was a total surprise, because I was invited to sit on what was called the Acoustics Review Group, which sort of was a sort of mixture of people who were invited to put our comments in. So, not surprisingly, the policy set out in HS2 ES is quite well wedded to the national policy. At the time it came out, the planning practice guidance on noise, I think, was in draft but hadn't been finalised, so it's in a bit of a gap. But you can see, if you dive into the relevant copy, where they've identified lulls and soles, ground build sound, construction operation, vibration as well, which is quite interesting. I mean, one of the things I perhaps should have said is all the national policy statements, that NSIP stuff, right at the beginning it says noise equals vibration, although there's actually no numbers about vibration. But, you know, if you find yourself with the vibration issues, the principles to apply are the same. And then it goes on to state what they think for this scheme, where a sole sits for various numbers. We're up in the 65s daytime, 55s at night. That's the operation of the railway. They've also, which I think is quite wise, said how they've pulled that number out, and they've linked it to the noise insulation regulations, give or take a bit. What else they might do is sole at night and the 55. If you know your night noise guidelines for Europe under World Health, it overtly says that 40 outside night is a lower LOAL. That's about the one thing that is stated out with what we've been doing in this country. I think that's broadly plausible. I haven't seen any good case for saying otherwise. What's quite interesting is also they went on to, I'll confuse myself in the order. Let me go back a bit. Not only did Seoul get defined in terms of an 8-hour LEQ, they also took account of a number of events and maximum levels. And if you were expected to get enough events at a high enough level, you got automatically kicked into significant impact, which I think was a nice way of trying to reconcile this problem we all have about should you use LEQ at night or should you use LMAXs. Well, here they've done it quite neatly. They've actually used both, which is probably the right answer. And then, as well, they defined where Lowell is. And if you think about it, lowest observed adverse effect level, if you're below that, no noise issue, nice and simple. So they said, okay, well, this is where far we're going to go. We don't think there's a problem below this, therefore we're not going to worry about it. Now, that's obviously getting heard through Parliament. I think there are some positioners who are arguing that they haven't got the numbers in the right place. There was certainly a document put forward by the grouping centred around Chiltern District Council, who I think are leading the opponents on operational noise. It's all on the HS2 website if you've got the time and inclination. But yes, it'll be interesting to see how that happens. They've just published, or relatively recently published, the first interim report of the Select Committee. And they've nagged all the petitioners not to keep going on about the World Health guidelines. So I think people are saying, oh, we've got to meet the WHO guidelines. And I think it sounds as if Rupert's possibly won the argument, no, you don't have to. And that was quite interesting. So that's a warning. And the only other observation, but not just on noise, was could more work be done on the health effects? Yeah, we know that. We're not nailed it yet. We're getting better. But I couldn't work out whether that's noise or whether that was noise and other things. But so there's been no mention yet. I think we might have to wait for the final report to see whether they accept what has been put forward as Sol and Lowell on this. The A14 highway, big arrangements up in towards East Anglia. The ES on that, again, there's a construction phase. Notice now, because this is post the planning practice guidance, there's also the unacceptable adverse effect level. Now, UAEL, that's something that's been written there. Will that come into common parlance? I don't know. It does sort of work, and it does fit with the policy. So you have that there. Again, they've tackled vibration, at least in terms of Lowell and Sol. As I said, if you're interested in the numbers, just go into the website. It takes a bit of finding. It's not the easiest thing to track down these things, but you can find them all. And then they've done something similar on operational noise as well. And again, we've got UAEL saying a daytime LEQ 16-hour of 74 is where it goes unacceptable. Now, that's quite interesting. Whether you agree with that or not, but that's what they're proposing for this scheme, and that's what will be tested when it goes in front of an examining authority. And I think my suggestion would be that what these two schemes in particular have done is given you a start of a 10 on high-speed rail and roads. Now, you don't have to follow it, and I think it would be rather lazy to say, well, because they did this in A14, we're going to do this for whatever. But at least it stops you having to scratch your head. And emerging evidence might come to say, well, 74 is a bit lively, it ought to be 72. The beauty of the policy, and I know I would say this, is it doesn't mention a number. And if a significant adverse effect can happen at a lower noise exposure, because the evidence says so, the policy doesn't have to change. It's just how we apply the policy has to change, because we have to use a different number. I then had a look at some local plans. This is actually surprisingly more difficult than you think. And to see how this was done, it just was difficult. But anyway, I found a few. I lighted on Lichfield. What could be clearer than values of Sol and Lowell? There's a whole raft of them there, all sorts of things. I haven't studied it, and I can't pass comment on whether I would agree with it or not. But if you go onto the Lichfield District Council website and eventually get to, it's sometimes supplementary planning guidance or those sorts of phrases that are used. You will find that. But then I looked at Worcestershire and I found the same table. So there's a bit of coordination going on in the West Midlands here. And I think it's identical. I didn't spend time going through every one on its own. But that was quite interesting. There's something for Crawley. Now, what Crawley have done is taken the PPG table and just put numbers to it, which I thought was quite a nice approach. Again, I haven't formed a view about whether I would agree with it or not. I mean, I glanced at one or two of them. I thought, well, that doesn't look too silly. But they have Crawley. I then alighted on Tunbridge Wells. Now, this sort of started well because it was a fantastic paragraph where they described what the following commentary is given. Now, I think it means their commentary. I must confess, I've never seen this written down elsewhere, but I might have missed it. No observed effect level inaudibility. Well, yeah, that's probably true. If you can't hear it, by definition, the sound's not having any effect on you whatsoever. LOAL. This is quite interesting. You know, guidelines in WHO, levels in BS 8233 and all the rest of it. And in Seoul, well, somewhere above a low, yeah, that's true, dependent on all sorts of issues. Now, I thought, well, that's quite a very clear statement. Let's see how this progresses. And then the very next paragraph, I got a bit disappointed because suddenly there was this new term called lowest observable exposure level. The adverse seems to have disappeared from that. Significant observable, so again, not quite the right language. It's almost as if who wrote 1.8 was different from the person who wrote 1.9. And then the standards are, well, they look pretty close to BS 8233 to me, and there's no souls or anything like that that I could find. So what started quite well, it was a little disappointing. Manchester City Council, arguably even more disappointing. Specific limits, internal levels, you know, this would work 10 years ago in terms of what's written there. Again, it looks broadly BS 8233. Now, there's nothing wrong with them saying we don't want any adverse effect, but it's not what government policy says. And there's kind of, at some point, somebody's going to get challenged on this and say, look, government policy says, as I said earlier, you could actually have a significant adverse impact if the value of what you're doing is great enough. But they've gone for that, including the 55 garden and amenity areas, acceptance in city centre when there are busy roads. So, you know, actually it's 55 except where it can't be. It'll make your mind up, you know. But this is a reference. It appears like a bullet point. This is a reference. They reference PPG 24, but it's now covered by the NPPF 2012. I don't think our friends in Manchester City have quite grasped this yet. But I mustn't be too critical of local authorities, because the other thing I did, you see I've got far too much time on my hand at the moment, I had a nose around to see what other assessments I could find on the web. Everything I've quoted to you on the slides is in the public domain. Now, here was the proposed ball court, April 2014, so that's a year ago. There are no recognised building standards, codes of practice, blah, 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 for activities. I have a horrible feeling it then degenerated into BS 4142. No mention of MPSC or MPPF. And yet, a proposed ball court, I think they mean tennis court, actually. I think that's what it was, but anyway. The MPSC applies and tells you what you've got to try and achieve. MPPF tells you what you've got to try and achieve. All right, you need to think about what the numbers are. No mention of that at all by the consultant. September 2012, okay, this wasn't long into the era of MPPF and MPSC, but actually, it was mentioned. Good on them. And they've said, until government publishes guidance, now that was the era when people were waiting with bated breath for the government, I suspect, to produce some numbers, we'll do what the local planning authority says. Well, that's a very sensible idea. MPPF has brought no real change to fundamentals of noise assessment. Well, again, that's true because the policy hasn't changed. We worry about how bad things are and try and bring them down. This was slightly alarming. During a recent conference held by the IoA and attended by DEFRA's representatives, the relevance of these currently used technical documents and guidance following the publication of the MPPF was discussed and confirmed. Wonder if that was me. Anyway, but it goes to show you have to be so careful when you have the government hat on what you say. It gets taken down and used in evidence. July 2013, this was a proposed residential development. MPPF and MPSC were mentioned. And it says the MPSC refers to WHO. It does, because I think it's because we say toxicology as expressed by WHO, hence the use of NOELs and LOELs. Therefore, the standards set out in WHO guidance have been used for setting noise limits. Well, I haven't quite got the linkage right there. You know, that's not quite what the MPSC MPSC said. And then July 2013, a skate park. No relevant guidance documents available. Well, yes, there were, because there's the MPSC and NPPF by June 2013. So consultants aren't applying the policy correctly yet either. And apart from the major infrastructure policy, you'll be relieved to know that I've reached the closing remarks. There is comprehensive noise policy in England. Interestingly, Northern Ireland, there is a noise policy statement for Northern Ireland that was published sometime last year. Not quite the same wording as the MPSC, but you can see where it was borrowed from. And as I hope I've demonstrated, it is pretty consistent across all policy areas that have been updated. Now, I can think of one that hasn't been updated, and arguably it's not consistent. But where there has been change, it has happened. As I have possibly laboured to death, one of the things in the MPSC is that if you're not sure about what to do, or if you come across something that's ambiguous, like that statement in the National Policy Statement, go back to the MPSC and see what the intent was. And I think that helpful statement in that decision letter about Thames Tideway gives a very clear steer about that's what should be done. If in doubt, go back to the core policies, the MPSC, NPPF, and so on. And my little brief survey showed that the application of it is evolving. It's quite structured in major infrastructure projects. I think that's because there's resource and time to be able to do it. It's becoming clearer in some local planning guidance, but as I showed also. But there are some, if you like, called routine noise assessments. I mean, as I said, there were just some examples I found from cruising on the internet the last couple of days, which didn't just fell short. What was stated by the consultant was wrong in terms of the policy. And I think that's, Peter and I were talking about how we could help as an institute. That's possibly one of the things we could help with. You know, no consultant should write there is no guidance anymore. Yes, there is. There might be no numbers, but there is guidance and there is policy. And as I said, we are moving from black box acoustics. There isn't a single number above that bad, below that good. It comes into play where you have law, and the example I can think of is Section 61 agreements for construction noise, because you know, magistrates will look at it in a very black and white way. And I'm afraid if you are 65.1 and you should have only been 65, then you're struggling. It is that bizarre experience. I don't know if you've ever dealt with Section 61 in magistrates' court, but if 65 is the number, the mood is 64.9 is peace and quiet and tranquil and delightful, and 65.1 is deafening. But that's the way the law works. But beyond that, you know, it isn't shoving a few numbers into the box and the computer says yes or no. We have to think about it more because there are a lot of factors. But as I said, and I thought it was worth emphasising again, local planning authorities can still have thresholds, but don't let them become fixed thresholds. And I'm wondering whether one of the challenges that we've got in getting this working is the pressure on local authority resources in terms of the skill base and just the sheer numbers. Is what I put there is hindering comprehensive and coherent implementation. I mean, the word I hear, I mean, a lot of my colleagues who I grew up with have disappeared and taken the money and now to be found somewhere in the south of France who used to be very good local authority officers. I don't know whether you've found the same now. They are struggling, I think. And again, is this somewhere where the Institute can help, Chartered Institute of Environmental Health, just help them. And I know some people told me, you might have experienced this with wind farm developments, that if the local authority don't stand up to them, the wind farm developer gets nervous, that they get hammered by the local residents. And so they actually pay for the local authority to challenge the environmental assessment that they have paid for to have done. So at least democracy seems to work. Now, if the local authority is a bit challenged on that, doesn't have the expertise, doesn't have the numbers, it's not going to work. And as I said, there are one or two, I've heard examples of people not exploiting the good intentions of some of the texts and the planning guidance. So what about the future, given we've got an election coming up? Well, the MPSC came in with Labour and, as I said, was adopted by the coalition. So it should probably survive a change of government. And in any case, I would argue it's quite apolitical. I mean, it's not left-wing or right-wing. It's just sort of stating what we've always done, and actually it's all quite plausible. Where there might be a difference is how proactively it's implemented. And it's almost one of the last comments I said to my colleagues. I said, you know, I don't think you need to change your policy, but what you might want to do is get proactive in certain areas. And of course, we've got a fantastic example at the moment with the money the Highways England have got, and they're no longer the Highways Agency, to deal with their important areas. And they've actually quoted a number. They're going to look at 1,160 important areas. They've got 75 million to spend on noise mitigation, which is three times the quantity they had when the Hansard sites and all that work was done around about the year 2000. I don't know, have to see. Who knows what the outcome is? But I thought, yeah, let's have a little look at the election manifestos. And due to the wonder of search engines, there's a little thing just to finish off with. How many times do you think the word noise is mentioned? The ones I looked at is Conservative, Labour, Lib Dem, UKIP and the Greens. Let's have your votes. The number of times the word noise appears in a manifesto.
None.
None? Any advances on none? All right, the consensus is none. The answer actually is two. All right, now this is gets, you know, right. It appears once in the Conservative manifesto. Can you think what the context might be?
Airports. HS2.
No.
Labour.
Sorry? Yes. The clue's up there, actually. We will build new roads and railways in a way that limits as far as possible the impact on the environment. This includes investing £300 million in cutting light pollution from new roads, doing more tunnelling, building better noise barriers. Now, I don't know if Ian Holmes, who's at the Highways England now, noise person there, realises he's not only got to build barriers, they've got to be better barriers. Although somebody was telling me today that there is somebody, I think there's been a research contract let about better noise barriers. I think they're doing something quite interesting up the M40 with solar panel noise barriers to generate electricity, so they actually become self-financing. So that's the first one. The second one is Lib Dems. And somebody said what it is. It was in the context of airports. We remain opposed to any expansion of Heathrow, Stansted or Gatwick and any new airport in the Thames Estuary because local issues of air and noise pollution. We will ensure no net increase in runways across Heathrow. So the fact that Manston's closed, does that mean we can have a new one at Heathrow? I don't know. Right. The next word I looked for was sound. Because I thought, you know, we're getting people emancipated these days. What about sound? How many times do you think sound was mentioned?
Six.
Six. Very close. The answer actually is five, but regrettably, none of them in an acoustic sense. So UKIP used the word sound four times. Our manifesto commitments are sound and affordable. UKIP will make a difference by being a powerful, much-needed voice in favour of sound financial management. Pensioners will now be making complex decisions about when and how much to take from their pension pots, and before doing so, they need expert advice to make sound, well-informed choices. And UKIP has sound policies that will put British farmers first. The Greens also managed to get the word sound in. Pensions need sound, long-running infrastructure to invest in, such as energy generation and social housing. So, okay, dealt with noise, dealt with sound. I was so worried about this. You know how some PDFs, they don't function the search. I actually thought, I'll just make sure, so I'll put, you know, economics in or something. Of course, it did work, so it was all right. I looked for the word quiet. Thought, I've done sound, quiet, this is good. Okay, quiet. I won't put you through this anymore. I found it once, and this is in the Greens. And actually, it wasn't the word quiet, it was quietly. It does all join up, they say. One fine day in April 2019, you will leave work at 5 p.m. on the dot and check the bus stop's electronic display. Your bus home is due in 3 minutes. It glides to a stop, wait for it, electric motor whirring quietly. And you beep on with your smart card. This is maybe something straight after. So, quietly. And I thought I'd look for the word tranquil, given it was in policy, and fun enough, it wasn't there. So our profession hasn't made a huge impact with the politicians. So I suspect that noise policy statement will probably last, especially if Labour and Conservative, because nobody's that bothered by it, which is okay, because I think it's good. There's a bit of consistency, so we'll have to see what happens. And if you're interested, Labour was the one that had no mention of noise, sound, quiet or sound in any context, and tranquil. All the other parties at least did trigger something in my little survey. A friend of mine has been chair of our local planning committee and talked about noise, and he's kind of his classic saying, trouble with noise, he said, is it's very complicated, no one on the planning committee understands it. Well, I just hope that these slides and this presentation have might shed some light on this current noise policy canvas. Thank you very much indeed.